Hi, I'm Kalki, and you're watching Kalki Presents My Indian Life, brought to you by the BBC World Service. These are actually stories about you, about being young and Indian. And I'm just really happy that you've been enjoying the season so far. And this episode is going to be no different. You're about to meet somebody extraordinary. I can't wait to hear what you have to say.
Did you ever dream of having a superpower when you were a child? A young boy called Shubham Choudhary did. And it was to become invisible. But it wasn't what you think. He didn't want that superpower to spy on anyone or to prank his friends. It was to hide from the pain. You see, Shubham was bullied and teased at school every single day, and he just wanted to escape his classmates. He was bullied because he was not like all the other boys in class. He was different.
While growing up, I was feminine. I mean, I never felt that, but of course, the people around me felt that. I kind of attracted a lot of unwanted attention, which was followed by abuse, name-calling, or harassment because I was not manly enough or boyish enough to fit into the social structure or stereotype of how a boy should be.
Shubham started to worry that there was something wrong with him, even though he was just being himself.
I used to be called all the words which are kind of directed derogatorily towards transgender people. And at that time, there was a lot of shame associated with it, you know. I don't want it to be associated with those words.
The classroom had become a scary place for Shubham, but he was destined to change that. This is the story of a young man who took his childhood trauma and turned it around. He made it his mission to help others understand gender and sexuality better. I'm Kalki Koechlin. From the BBC World Service, this is Kalki Presents My Indian Life, the podcast about being young and Indian in the 21st century. Season 3, Episode 7, The Boy Who Fought Back. Everyone around Shubham had opinions on how he should behave, on how any boy should behave, really, and did not hesitate to voice them. This included members of his family, his classmates, even members of the community he belonged to. The Jats, an agricultural community mostly living in Delhi, Haryana, Punjab, and Rajasthan.
So I think from very early on, I was getting these messages of being strong, be more masculine. I should look into how I walk or how I talk, change my body language. And like all my cousins are really masculine, well-built. Everyone should learn how to ride a bike. Everyone should own a bullet when they are young. And later on, they should have a Scorpio. You know, these are kind of a set benchmark for, you know, Jat boys to be. The funny thing is that some of them also write, you know, on their bike nameplate, Chart Boys, and, you know, have that Z after boy.
Just to interject, a bullet is an Indian motorbike, a very popular one, and a Scorpio is a big SUV. Shubham says it seemed to him that some members of the Jat community even seemed to define how men should speak.
You know, when they say it has to be very powerful, like how you speak, you know. I mean, in Hindi, I would say like very dhos jama ke bolna, you know.
That loosely translates as speak like you're threatening or bullying someone. Like you have the authority to say something. Shubham didn't relate to any of this, but he says he couldn't really talk to anyone about how he felt either, neither at home nor at school. Petrified of the boys in his class, Shubham naturally found himself gravitating towards the girls in search of friendship.
Yeah, I think I can say this. I survived my school life because every year I had one girlfriend who kind of held me in that space.
But even with his friends, it wasn't like Shubham felt comfortable enough to talk about the bullying he was facing.
It was always unsaid until today. I've never discussed because I said that I had a lot of shame discussing it. So I never brought it up. They never brought it up.
So it was a struggle to go to school. Shubham was so scared of being bullied that he wouldn't go to the washroom for the entire day.
It's again a very close space where you're out of the reach of the teachers, where you're out of the reach of other peers. I used to avoid going to washroom for, you know, entire school time, which used to be like roughly 7 a.m. to 2 p.m.
7 hours of holding one's bladder cannot be healthy psychologically or physically, but that's what Shubham felt he needed to do. And that same fear stretched to the playground too.
There's this one boy who used to sing this song. It goes like this, Nari Nari. So, you know, using that Nari word.
Nari is a Hindi word for a woman.
Those were the kind of things people used to call out.
Years later, when Shubham finally graduated, he was really, really happy and relieved. So much so that he decided to pursue his college education through correspondence. That's how much he wanted to stay away from his peers. And he spent the next 2 years of his life cooped up in his room with one thing for company, films.
I think from very early on, I got into art cinema. Probably I was 8th standard. And I used to watch all the possible art, you know, movies. And because somewhere I think I was finding that alternate narrative of, you know, being, which was not there in the mainstream cinema. So I think that was a window for me, a distant window that how a life can be different from what is all around me. That was like my escape from the real life.
Shubham immersed himself in films like Hazaar Chaurasi Ki Maa and Bandit Queen and really started to feel like he could relate to those narratives well.
I wanted to consume a lot of sadness also, you know, at that point of time, because I could connect with that sadness. And that's why maybe I was so drawn to it. You know, I was not drawn to the mainstream cinema, which is about a hero and a heroine and fighting and love songs and item songs and all those sort of those things. But I was more into the realities of life, real experiences of people, real suffering of people, which I could connect to more versus a hero found a heroine and, you know, they lope together and then they're singing and dancing in some foreign country, you know.
I do know. I work in Bollywood and I also grew up in a school where we used to live right next to the botanical gardens in Ooty. And they used to have a lot of these song and dance shoots that used to happen. We used to watch them as kids. So it is a very much a part of commercial cinema in India and not necessarily something that all of us can relate to. It was only after college that things started to really change in Shubham's life. One day, while he was scrolling through his social media accounts, he came across a photograph that he couldn't stop looking at.
This one photo a friend shared on Facebook where there was this woman who was sitting on a bullet.
That's the Indian bike, remember?
A lot of coal in her eyes.
That's eyeliner.
Messy hair and was smoking a cigarette. And I got very intrigued by that photograph.
The photograph was playing on stereotypes. The woman sitting on a motorbike, the cigarette that she was smoking. It was all very provocative. That photograph led him down a rabbit hole. It was part of an album of photos that Shubham found very fascinating. He soon learned that the album was part of a campaign called Must Bowl, which invited people to present their interpretations of what constitutes masculinity through photographs.
So there was this one woman sitting on a bike, smoking a cigarette. There was other man who was playing with a child. And the entire album was very refreshing.
In Shubham's world up until then, these images would be the opposite of masculine. But these interpretations made sense to him. He found himself thinking, finally, someone who thinks like me. Shubham got in touch with the people who ran the campaign and was thrilled to find out that they were looking for more volunteers to join them. Shubham signed up immediately. The campaign aimed to create awareness about gender-based violence using art. Shubham felt that this was a sign. Wide-eyed, he spent endless hours absorbing all that the campaign had to offer.
That one campaign literally changed my life. In the initial days of the campaign, we got through this induction and training where we learned about gender, we learned about violence, we learned about patriarchy. And, you know, all these things which I'm experiencing, you know, all along, all these years, I finally had a language to sum up what I was going through. I could never have called this what I was experiencing was gender-based violence, right?
He was finally equipped with the vocabulary to describe and also share what he had gone through in his childhood, the bullying, the name-calling.
Also, the people I met there were a very interesting bunch of people. And it was more like, you know, coming home for me, where I could see people living their life on their terms.
One of the women he met during the campaign had gone through a very similar experience to Shubham's. All her life, she had been called out for being too masculine. And when Shubham spoke with her, it felt like they were both being finally understood.
There was a lot of similarities in kind of, experiencing we have gone through in our life, you know, the experience of marginalization, the experience of discrimination, the experience of harassment we have been subject to while growing up. So it was like for the first time in my life, I felt like I belong. And that's a very amazing feeling to have, that you're not alone.
But perhaps the most important revelation that Shubham had during the campaign was that he had no reason to feel ashamed. None of it was his fault.
It's the social construct around me which has created this kind of environment where I was bullied.
And you know, when he says the campaign really changed his life, he really means it. Because soon after it ended, Shubham decided that he wanted to do his bit to ensure nobody went through what he had gone through. And this time, he chose a very specific venue for his work. He wanted to go back to the classroom, the place where it all started for him. And he got that opportunity soon enough. In the winter of 2012, a 22-year-old woman was beaten, tortured, and gang-raped in a moving bus in Delhi. It sparked outrage, and there were protests in every city demanding justice. Shubham took part in a few of the protests and got involved in another campaign called Safe Delhi. Shubham and another volunteer were asked to visit a boys' school and talk to them about gender-related violence. The aim? To make the city a safer place for women.
So this was me, 20-year-old, going back to school to talk about gender, you know, masculinity and violence. And I was really scared, you know, but this was me going back, talking to kids, and these kids few years back were my, you know, peers who have really made my life miserable.
So, a very nervous Shubham enters the classroom again, hoping that this time the kids he meets will be kinder to him than the ones back in his school in his childhood. What he went through in school was a big reason Shubham wanted to do this, but there was more to it.
What I realized was that it is more meaningful, it is more constructive to engage with kids because they are willing to listen, to reflect, and question.
Shubham says that ultimately change had to come from the children themselves, but that could only happen if they were encouraged to be curious and question things around them. For instance, that day when he was with the students, he heard one of them casually mention something. One boy told him that if someone, say his classmate, beat him in school, he would have to beat them back. He just had to. It was the norm. It was what was expected of him. Shubham switched to Hindi to tell me more about the conversation.
That agar unhe koi marta hai, aur...
He says that if a child came home complaining that he was hit by another boy, the parents would ask the child why he didn't hit back.
Tu kyun nahi peet kar aaya? Like, again, putting them pressure that you had to react and you have to respond. Continuing that circle of violence and putting that pressure on them to respond in a certain way.
That day, Shubham engaged the children in a series of questions and answers. He was hoping to get them to question stereotypes, both in terms of gender and violence.
I think, you know, me going to one school, or two school, or three school, or, you know, interacting with a bunch of kids one of a time is not going to really change things. It has to happen at more systematic level. The teachers need to take a more active part in this.
That experience of talking to children made Shubham realize that he wanted to do more work with them. He wanted to continue talking to children. He wanted to work at the grassroots, in the hope that he could bring an attitudinal change, especially when it came to gender. Shubham, by this time, was also a changed person. From the shy boy who wanted to become invisible, he had become a man who had found himself.
I really wanted to do something, kind of compensate the lost years, you know? So I wanted to do something to push my boundaries.
And right on cue, he heard about the Gandhi Fellowship, which encourages young people to do their bit to transform the public education system in the country. Shubham applied to be a part of it and got selected. He was chosen to go to Jardol, a village near Udaipur in Rajasthan, and work with the schools there. The idea was to help children improve their learning outcome. I couldn't help thinking about the kind of change maker that Shubham had become by this point. At the end of his 2-year stint in Jardol, Shubham was raring to go, eagerly looking forward to his next project, and he had really started to notice a change in nearly every aspect of his life, including the kind of connections and relationships he was forging with people around him.
I can pick and choose whom I want to be with versus I'm forced to be in the classroom I don't want to be in, right? So I think the bottom line is when you are more comfortable in your skin, everything changes around you, in you. You can form much more authentic relationship with others.
Today, Shubham is the CEO of a startup called Safe Access that acts as a liaison between hospitals and the LGBTQ+ community. He has heard reports and testimonies of several people who were harassed, abused, and even subject to violence while accessing healthcare. So he wanted to do something about that.
When a queer and trans person feel that there is a need to go and seek healthcare, the first thing probably which happens is delay in seeking care, because the immediate question comes is whom they can consult. And finding that one health service provider is a journey in itself, and especially when it comes to sexual reproductive health.
So what Shubham did was help curate a list of friendly and safe doctors and hospitals and make them available to the LGBTQ+ community. Safe Access also helps healthcare providers with guidelines on how to communicate with the LGBTQ community, hoping to create a more sensitive and compassionate healthcare system. The road to change is still bumpy. Shubham says not all doctors or hospitals are willing to listen, but that a start has been made. He especially mentions 2018 as the year that really transformed things in a big way for the LGBTQ+ community. That was the year, on September 6th, that the Supreme Court read down the infamous Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code that had made gay sex a criminal offense. After many years of constant protests and litigation, the Supreme Court of India concluded that it violated the constitutional right to equality and dignity. Things were very different before the Supreme Court ruling.
There was a lot of reluctance from the health service providers to come on board because, of course, there was this law which was very vague and they are not sure whether they are on the good side or the bad side of the law. So that whole confusion was something they don't want to engage with it.
Shubham says that the judgment changed many attitudes, for sure, especially the healthcare industry. But of course, he adds, there's still a lot more to do. After listening to Shubham's story, I can't help but think again about that young child who was bullied into believing that something was really wrong with him. I asked Shubham how he looks back at his journey.
Nobody has ever asked me this question, like how I feel about this. And I think I've never said this, but I feel immensely proud of myself and my journey and how I turned, you know, my life into something which I cherish.
Last year, Shubham made it into the Forbes list of 30 under 30, a list of change makers.
Growing up, I could never imagine that I could be Forbes 30 under 30. So I feel immensely proud.
Shubham has indeed found meaning in the experiences from his childhood.
I think I'm a much more sensitive person, a much more aware person, a much more kind person because of the things which happened to me. I don't wish anyone go through that kind of, journey in order to learn this lesson. But I wish that people should learn this lesson, maybe by media, maybe by their parents, their peers, their teachers, other places. But I wish that people learn lessons of kindness, about diversity, about inclusion, about respecting the differences, about seeing how people are.
And where is Shubham headed next? But believe it or not, back to the classroom again. He hopes to do his master's sometime soon and enjoy the experience of a college, one that he never managed to have. In the next episode of Kalki Presents My Indian Life, when her father died, Archana Soreng wanted to fulfill his one wish, to protect her tribal community's way of life. Today, that ambition has blossomed into a much bigger fight against climate change.
I make myself realize that you can't sit idle if you are angry. You need to take some action. And even if it is a small action, it will make difference.
Kalki Presents My Indian Life is an All Things Small production for the BBC World Service. And I hope you've been enjoying listening to Season 3 so far. If you like this podcast, please hit the follow or subscribe button on your podcast app. You can find us on BBC World Service on Twitter and Facebook, or use the hashtag MyIndianLife with your comments and suggestions. Thanks for listening. This season of Kalki Presents My Indian Life has been researched, scripted, and produced by Archana Nathan. Gaurav Vaz is our executive producer. Our audio producer is Sachi Rajadhyaksh, with editing support by Nikhil Rao. The podcast was mixed and mastered by Ayan Deh.